I don't have it in presentation format, but these are something. So let's say this is your sales chart.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see that you've not done phenomenally well because it's almost been flat. Right. How do you de-emphasize it?
Remove the zero thing.
No. So add more space.
Oh, add more space.
So suddenly everything looks same. Right. So that's another bit. Then, and if your figure suddenly went up here, what you do is you change this from 0 to 20k.
Yeah.
Now because your axis is smaller, this difference looks larger.
That is a crime.
Another trick is
if you click on that option, a punch should come to your face.
Yes.
Another trick is to change from a linear to log axis. So
yeah.
Within the log, if the difference is actually, you want the difference to look small, use a log axis. In a linear axis, it will look big.
Won't people figure out log axis because the axis labels will become dramatically lower.
Keep the labels
so
same.
So here you have four tick marks. Right. You remove these four tick marks. So your upper limit and lower limit is still the same.
Still the same.
So it's $0 to $100,000, but you don't use this for y axis.
Okay.
So the guy cannot figure out that it's a log axis.
Yeah.
Very nice.
You should have gone for them.
Late now.
Okay, so this one is very so India, if you've seen media taking the glory award that we are the number one media, look at the fine print. Some of the best media companies in India, they say we are the number one based on change of growth in subscribers, not just change in number of subscribers, based on change of growth of subscribers in week 3 of that particular month. That's like you're beating the data actually to make yourself number one till you figure out you're not number one in that way. That's always a fine print. So percentages are actually your best friend. So here, let's say you did not grow very well. You only grew, let's say, 12%, which does not even beat the inflation today. But you want to show that you're actually better than your competitors, but they have bigger revenues than you. So you show that they have actually grown smaller than you, or slower than you, and then you've grown faster as percentages. That's another one. This is my favorite. If you want to, so here your sales have grown down, right?
Mm.
And you don't want the guy to focus on that. You do two things. You make the chart as loud as possible that focuses on this bar and this thing and this bar here. And then you go back to this column and just write on top of this column, record sales in 5 years. The guy looks at March and he forgets about this. And you make it loud. Another thing is you can opt not to show values. But if you want to show or highlight a value, highlight something, then you can show values. So this is another trick. Yes.
So a lot of the clients are salespeople, is it?
Yeah, put that on your side.
So this is the SVG performance of 3D within a browser. And it was the same on iPhone as well, so touch enabled. So yeah, I think pretty much that's it. But what I want to conclude is we've just started seeing data visualization. Data visualization as an industry has not changed in 250 years. We're still using the same chart types. We're still like, there's a guy, William, who built the first column chart, or bar chart, however you call it. We have not changed that at all. With the new data coming in, with new devices, and with tablet and mobile as being, which will be the primary form of consumption, and new methods and lowest common denominator now being HTML5, or even your local native application now, frameworks like iOS or anything, or Android, there's so much more to be done. There's a whole industry which is being built up around this right now. I mean, BI's industry is $15 billion industry, growing every single year. Just in this niche category, we had Tableau software, which I IPO'd a month ago at $2 billion, primarily focused on visual exploration. We have Splunk, which has got, obviously they've got log management and search, but they've got amazing visualization. You can look at ClickTech, Spago BI, the whole bunch of them. So if you're taking data visualization seriously right now, you're just poised for awesome growth, and it's awesome fun subject because it combines psychology. It's not just one thing. It combines so many different things that you get to read random stuff, you get to practice random stuff on people, you call up people in office and say, I'm going to do this experiment on you. There's a whole lot of fun. So,
it's like, we've used Splunk and we've used Logstash combined with Kibana, which is like a UI front end for it. Mm-hmm. If you compare the two, you'll see Kibana gives you a lot more flexibility in open source than what Splunk has done. But Splunk has actually come up with the new big data streams and searches, which are really good. But as far as visualization is concerned, Kibana, I think, is stuck with it.
Like, I've not looked at Kibana, but now definitely.
Probably tried. It works on Logstash.
Okay.
So you have to have Logstash as a log management, so everything goes into Elasticsearch. So there's a visualization front end for it.
Okay. We'll definitely look it up. All right. Any questions or anything?
There's a lot of content on pre-trained processing for static charts. The one that you were mentioning about height, width, the rectangles being small or big, and how your tension goes, right? Mm-hmm. Have you done something on animation, and do you have something to share about?
So have we done button animations?
I mean, you have animated motion charts as well, right? Okay. So do you do some research, or do you refer to some research before making them, or is it just what
so
you find which works?
Just avoid animations. While we give animations do not actually add any value to your charts. The only thing which adds value is transitions. It's transitions smoothen out the change. So when you're looking at one chart and it morphs into another chart, or the axis changes, the transition smoothens out so that you can see the value of the impact of the data going up and down. Any initial animation or anything which is jumpy, bouncy, has no value. Avoid it for ideal data visualization, but if you have to go and sell, these get you money. Very simple.
So what are your views on some of the existing popular JavaScript charting libraries, for example, D3.js, HiCharts, and
so one JavaScript, building a JavaScript charting library has become an international hobby. Every week we are seeing one new of them, and practically one every week, and I'm getting email from my team. So here's the thing, right? This is an industry which is just starting. There are going to be so many players. Each one will come up with a very specific fundamental. So our fundamental right now is still to serve those guys who have the money, who need the enterprise features, the comprehensiveness of our suite, APIs, i6, 7, 8, we go on that. HiCharts is very plain vanilla looks and saying that, you know what, we give you a very strong JavaScript API, so they are very pro developers. We are still not as good for developers, like very serious, very good JavaScript developers, they do not like us as much as HiCharts. But because of our support and a whole bunch of other philosophies in business, we do. D3, so the example I give is, between D3 and Fusion Charts, we are the Subway, right? You go into a Subway, you buy a sandwich, you know exactly what sandwich you want, and you come out and you know you're given a guaranteed experience of the quality and hygiene. Whereas D3 is going to a supermarket, you have all the varieties. You can take from the finest Italian bread to the crappy bread, go slice your cucumber and pick up the onions and pickles and everything, then build it on your own. How good a chef you are is up to you. Do you have the time to build it? Is that your core focus or priority? Is that going to derail from your business plan or like whatever you're doing for thing? Do you need support tomorrow if you leave the company as an enterprise? Who will go and actually go and support that? So, but D3 is very, very, very powerful. So it's completely new. I mean, obviously you're aware, but there are certain things which D3 can not do, which Fusion Charts can do, which is all batteries pack, everything included. Any chart which you build will look perfect. Labels will not overlap, however long they are. Those small things we take care of. Whereas in D3, everything you will have to manage. So. But with D3, the kind of transitions you can do, the kind of forms you can make out of charts, the extensions that you can do, it's just mad.
Right.
Is there any general use case where the 3D visualizations fit in?
The biggest use case? Make money. So, there are certain 3D visualizations which are necessary. So, scientific charts, there's something called surface chart. You cannot represent a surface chart in 2D. It has to be a 3D chart. Then. Recently I saw a very interesting visualization from Microsoft on a globe. They're doing 3D bar charts on a globe to represent something, I forgot.
Search queries or something.
Something they were doing. But it looks very beautiful. So you have this entire atlas. There are 3D columns popping up. So it's almost like you can imagine skyscrapers on the globe that was popping up. But again, those are very good to look at, right? But if you have to really compare data. So I'll show you one of our 3D charts. And we have two kinds of 3D charts, and the first one is mathematically wrong, but so if you look at this 3D chart, this looks like a 3D, but it's actually not a 3D chart, because this is a straight line for all of them, there's no perspective.
Nice.
So it gives you the ability to compare data without being wrong and following a line, but at the same time it gives you the 3D look and feel. And I'll show you the other two 3D charts that we have. This is our real 3D, our homegrown 3D in it. Here you can't even see those values, and to be able to see those values, you can actually have to go and then rotate on top of it and then come back, or you have to actually right click and then view 2D, which then goes back. So both have different use cases. This is not good for comparison, but gives you a nice fancy fit. I mean, imagine if you have to go and show this in a B-school guys and business guys love it. You just rotate it like, wow, you can rotate it. And for the next 2 minutes, they'll only rotate it. I've seen senior guys, I showed them once, they're like, this is cool, and he's rotating the chart. So same with the pie chart. So some of these things help us get into that.
While he's doing it, you quietly slip in your contract, just sign that.
On a serious note, I mean, things are more interesting than gamified, right? So these are kind of like gamified versions of things.
So
but though they are wrong for the intention, but I mean, for interaction perspective, they are really cool, right?
Correct. I don't disagree with that, right? But look at, so you have to look at it, what is your goal and audience, again, which is knowing your audience. If your goal of the data visualization is to serve a very clear purpose, with the purpose of which is to interpret data and make meaning out of it, or to drive to a business outcome, these charts do not add any value to it. Yes, they can help you do the same thing, maybe visually slightly different, but they don't add any value to it. Are there downsides to it? Yes, because A, the fact that it's 3D, so this might be misrepresented. Like a previous column 3D chart, that's actually a 2D chart made to look like 3D, so there you cannot go wrong. But this one is wrong. So I'll show you a 3D pie chart. I'll actually show. So there you will actually, like slicing the back rear will not look right. Anyways, you should not use a pie chart. There's another interesting chart I'll show. So we keep on trying and figure out like what can we do with chart more. So today if you look at data visualization, it's still a very one-way street where you look at the data visualization, it tells you something, you absorb it and you go. We're trying to figure out, can we make it a dialogue instead of a monologue? So where people can come and play with the data visualization, it actually goes back into database. So something like, this is an editable chart. So like here, again, remember what the dots are for?
Projections.
So here we're saying, these are your 2005 actuals, this is 2006 actuals. As a CEO, I'm giving you the opportunity to go and change the values on the chart. So I just go drag and drop this based on what I want to do. So then you're actually changing values on the chart. Otherwise, the guy would have gone and typed it. Now, the benefit of changing this on the chart is he can actually see the difference. When he's typing that value, he has to do a cognitive load of how much percentage is this higher. When I look at this, let's say I want to have revenues more than 120K also. So I just go and do like, let's say 240,000. And then I go and say, this year I'll be predicting this. So this is one example.
So when you change these graphs, is there a method of callback to send data back?
Obviously, otherwise what would we do with the data? So that's one. Then another is, obviously this was on a comm chart. Then we have on the line chart, same thing. Then we're looking at what kind of representation. So we're looking at a tree representation. And how can we do a different kind of a tree representation where the tree is not very deep. Depth would be, let's say, 3 or 4. So if you look at the problem with the trees today is you look at the leaf and then you have to go to the parent and parent and parent. There's a cognitive load to go to the parent and the parent and the grandparent. We said, how do we solve that using visualization? So he said, okay, this is a multi, this is also a tree. If you look, three child, child of each, child of each. Now, if I want to go and just look at this, the moment I hover over this, actually the color is not very correct. It traces it back color. So just change, look at the change in color. So there's no cognitive load. It's a visual function where you can easily trace it back. This works for 4 or 5 levels. Beyond that, it does not work in terms of depth of tree.
Then this is okay for offset kind of thing, but no good for comparing magnitudes.
So actually, you can compare magnitudes. So because the circumference of this is actually represent.
Again, the same problem.
Same problem, yeah. So you'll have that problem. But it's good. So think about this. One of the interesting use cases we have found is for an AdWords account. How do you visualize your entire AdWords account based on spend? And then how do you color code it? So there are two axes to it. One is the size and one is the color. Let's say your CTR or CPA is one your key metric. So based on the gradient of the object, you can depict good CPA or a good CTR. And then the size says, this is how much I'm spending on that. So you get a holistic picture and your exploration is good. Yes, it will not give you comparison.
Actually, you are right. We use exactly the same thing inside InMobi. We had a donut chart and we had a, because these two are like orthogonal metrics. but it makes sense when there are derivative metrics and there are a lot of dimensions. And for example, you want to see the country, and even sometimes the regions have, like, for example, one set could be like Europe, and then inside Europe you have individual countries. Mm-hmm. Then this makes a lot of sense to see those derivative metrics and show the hierarchy as well. In one shot. So yeah, donut charts are like good in like very very specific cases.
And then so interactive, one thing which I did not cover was interactivity. So let's say you're showing let's look at this one. You're showing a CPU utilization rate chart. And you can clearly see there are certain areas where the CPU is being utilized very high. Now you want to narrow it down between, let's say, 90 and 100. You just drag it here to 90 and let's say 70, you can just go and do that. So suddenly from seeing an entire chart, you can narrow it down to so much, and it's so intuitive to the user because of this slider here that it helps him converge to the data point he's currently looking at. This is
shouldn't the colors readjust? I mean, shouldn't the gradient be, I mean, when you do that, shouldn't 70 become the new 0 and...
No, maybe you go back from 70 then.
No, when you compress it, because now I want to see, when you made it between 70 and 90, right?
Correct.
Then so I'm not able to clearly distinguish
what is 90, what is...
What is 70, but yeah, if my 70 became closer to 0, I mean, it like replotted
between...
Relative, kind of.
Did that. So what happens is, if we change that colors, suddenly your perception of the color has changed. When you go back to the original, now you're confused, is this green equal to that green, or did I change the colors? So remember the drill down chart also, I said keep the same chart. When you're going in a specific visualization, if you're changing the experience, narrowing down the data or doing anything, just narrow it down to that one parameter. Here we are just narrowing it down to that set. Do not change anything else, because we cannot perceive and cannot compare two different changing things at the same time. We are good at only doing one thing at a time.
The other thing is, after you're narrowing down the range, it's already narrowed down, so you can easily compare with the numbers. You don't need that differentiation.
Not necessary. Okay. If the data set is
large. Yeah, if the data set is large.
Does Fusion Charts have anything for graphs?
For?
Network graphs.
So this is still a manual layout. It's not an automatic layout, but it's highly attractive. So you can like kind of drag and drop here. You can actually go and add new nodes. This example does not have, you can basically right click and add a new node or through JavaScript API configure and all of that. And this is kind of flexible in the way that you can actually build an org tree also out of this. So this is an org tree you build using a network graph. Another interesting thing is, on the dialog part of the graph, how do you enable graph as a way of input? Data visualization as a way of input. Right now, all data visualizations are a way of outputs. So let's say this was my investment, this is my return still date, this is my age. So I can clearly see that this bunch of investments are not working for me because they have been there for 9 years, but they're giving me less than 100% return. I want to collectively analyze what is happening with this. Mm-hmm. Today what I have to go is do check. Here what you can just go and do is select these, and select these. And then once submit, right from the chart you are taking an input. It's awesome, because it's much more visual and people can really understand it. These are some, most of this what I showed you can be done with T3, and you can make it much better. The only thing is it will take your time, but it's a fun journey, so definitely. But if you build something cool, definitely email it to me, share it with me. My email is pallav@fusionchats.com. I'd be happy to help you, comment, possibly collaborate with you on the code as well. So we are a commercially open source company. So any time you buy a license, you get the entire source code of our product. So we don't believe in patents as of now. Right?
I'm not sure if I can make this announcement right now, but Pallav also offered to do some office hours. We'll send you an email with all the details about it. But thanks a lot. I think this was quite good, no?
Very nice.
So if anybody of you are looking to use Fusion Charts for your current project, just drop me an email, I'll send you a license right away. And you can not just use it here, use it for your personal things as well.
Fine.
So pallav@fusioncharts.com.